Last week, the stage was set for us, and the actors were introduced. We were given the condition of the Israelites in Egypt as oppressed slave laborers, and why they were in that condition, because the newest king of Egypt didn't honor Joseph's memory or promises that were made to him. Now, further, we learned that this new king was an Egyptian, and he was not part of the line of the now defeated Semite kings that had ruled beginning a short time before Joseph came to Egypt, and for about 150 years after he arrived. Now, this new pharaoh was quite concerned, naturally, that foreigners, meaning those of non-Egyptian heritage, would never again have an opportunity to rule over Egypt, causing such great humiliation. Now, as Egyptians were of the line of Ham, as opposed to the Hebrews, who were of the line of Shem, there were very visible and obvious racial differences between these two groups of people. The evidence is that while a few Hebrews assimilated into everyday traditional Hebrew culture, the bulk of them hung on to and further developed a somewhat different looking Israelite culture. Now, what with the recent bitter taste of subjugation that these natural-born Egyptians suffered at the hand of these Semite kings, the prosperity that these Hebrews had enjoyed and the desire of the Egyptian rulers to put Egypt back onto the world stage as a powerful nation, Pharaoh decided that the Hebrew population had to be controlled. This he tried to accomplish by both keeping their numbers from growing further and by enslaving them for the purposes of being Egypt's construction workers. Open your Bibles to Exodus chapter 2. Exodus chapter 2. If you have a complete Jewish Bible, it's page 60. Page 60, if you have a complete Jewish Bible. We're at Exodus chapter 2. A man from the family of Levi took a woman also descended from Levi as his wife. And when she conceived and had a son, upon seeing what a fine child he was, she hid him for 3 months. And when she could no longer hide him, she took a papyrus basket, coated it with clay and tar, put the child in it, and placed it among the reeds of the riverbank. Now his sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe in the river with her maids in attendance walking along the riverside. Spotting the basket among the reeds, she sent her slave girl to get it, and she opened it and looked inside, and there in front of her was a crying baby boy. And moved with pity, she said, "This must be one of the Hebrews' children." And at this point, his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Would you like me to go and find you one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you?" And Pharaoh's daughter answered, "Yes, go." So the girl went and called the baby's own mother. And Pharaoh's daughter told her, "Take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will pay you for doing it." So the woman took the child and nursed it. And then when the child had grown some, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she began to raise him as her son. She called him Moshe, explaining, "Because I pulled him out from the water." Now one day when Moses, was a grown man, he went out to visit his kinsmen, and he watched them struggling at forced labor. And he saw an Egyptian strike a Hebrew, one of his kinsmen. And he looked this way and that, and when he saw that no one was around, he killed the Egyptian and hid his body in the sand. Now the next day he went out and saw two Hebrew men fighting with each other, and to the one in the wrong he said, "Why are you hitting your companion?" And he retorted, "Who appointed you ruler and judge over us? Do you intend to kill me the way you killed that Egyptian?" Well, Moshe became frightened. Clearly he thought the matter's become known. And when Pharaoh heard of it, He tried to have Moshe put to death, but Moshe fled from Pharaoh to live in the land of Midian. Well, one day as he was sitting by a well, the seven daughters of the priest of Midian came to draw water, and they had filled the troughs to water their father's sheep when the shepherds came and tried to drive them away. But Moshe got up and defended them. Then he watered their sheep. When they came to Reuel, their father, he said, "How come you're back so soon today?" And they answered, "An Egyptian rescued us from the shepherds. More than that, he drew water for us and watered the sheep." And he asked his daughters, "Where is he? Why did you leave the man there? Invite him to have something to eat." Moshe was glad to stay on with the man, and he gave Moshe his daughter Zipporah in marriage. She gave birth to a son. He named him Gershom, for he said, "I've been a foreigner in a foreign land." Now, sometime during those many years, the king of Egypt died, but the people of Israel still groaned under the yoke of slavery, and they cried out. And their cry for rescue from slavery came up to God. God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov. God saw the people of Israel, and God acknowledged them. Verse 1 gives us some important information. It is that a man from the house of Levi married a woman from the same house, it says. In other words, both the husband and the wife are of the same tribe, tribe of Levi. Don't get too concerned by this. By this time, there was probably around 100,000 Levites living in Egypt. So the gene pool was pretty large. That said, we're going to find out that Moses' parents were apparently pretty closely related. For now, the future parents of Moses will be anonymous. Later on, we're going to find out that his mother's name is Yehoabed. His father is Amram. Now, before Moses was born, his parents had produced two other children, Miriam and Aaron. Now, keep in mind throughout the remainder of our study of Torah that Moses was of the tribe of Levi. This is key. It's going to help to explain much of what happens concerning Moses. And by the way, as of this moment, the Bible has not yet indicated that Levi was going to be a tribe divided away and set apart for God. They're going to be a tribe of priests. So at this moment, by any way the Israelites would have viewed themselves, there were 13 tribes of Israel. Because Joseph had received the double portion blessing from his father Jacob by having Joseph's two sons included as full-fledged Israelite tribes. Now, just a reminder that when we speak of the 12 tribes of Israel, it's a rather sloppy statement because the number of tribes, who was counted among that number, varied over hundreds and hundreds of years. So we see that Moses is born under Pharaoh's decree of instant death to all male Hebrew newborns, and that his parents were able to hide him for about 3 months. But then it seemed to them impossible to keep his existence secret any longer. Now, did they think that they needed to go to some extraordinary measure to try and save him because they knew that this infant would one day become a deliverer of Israel? There's no indication of that at all. When they put Moses into that waterproofed basket and they set it into the Nile, it was with a faith that had not come about because of any kind of a special revelation that we've been told about. It was but a simple daily trust in God that this child's fate, no matter what it is, death or life, was in his holy hands. Well, hidden within the Hebrew language of the original text are several ironies and connections between the circumstances surrounding Moses' birth and some earlier benchmark biblical events. Naturally, the early sages and rabbis didn't miss these connections. The first is that in verse 2, it says that Moses' mother saw how beautiful he was. So she hid him for 3 months. Now, actually, what the original Hebrew says is that she saw how tov, Moses was. Tov is anyone who knows the slightest Hebrew. Tov means good. Saying beautiful isn't wrong. It's kind of an extension of that. But it masks the association that starts to be made between Moses and these earlier biblical acts of God. Now remember in Genesis 1 that after each part of the creation effort, God pronounced it to be good. You could just as easily have pronounced it as beautiful. Tov. And right off, it is being made clear that Moses' very birth was under divine influence and it was going to have a great purpose. Now, Moses' mother built a floating cradle out of some kind, rather out of the same material that the typical Nile river boats were made out of. Papyrus reed. And she seals it with natural tar. Again, the same way that Nile river boats were waterproofed. She then places Moses within it. Now, some Bibles call this little lifeboat a basket. Others call it an ark. The Hebrew word that's used here is teva, teva. And it is used in only two contexts in the entire Bible. The first refers to that enormous vessel that Noah piloted and built. The second is this tiny one here in Exodus. The one Moses was placed into. The correct English translation of teva is ark. Basket or any other word misses the mark. See, because we're meant to see this connection between Noah's ark and Moses' ark. Now notice the parallel purposes of these two arks. In Genesis, mankind was to be done in by a worldwide flood of water, and God saw to it that Noah and his family would be the saviors of mankind by placing them safely in a teva to ride atop the floodwaters. In Egypt, all Israelite male babies were to be done in by drowning in the Nile. But God saw to it that Moses would be the deliverer of Israel by placing him in a teva to ride atop the waters of the Nile. You see the connection? There's no allegory here. It's a pattern and a type that's being set down by God. Here we have God using water and an ark as the main elements of early types of salvation. The first kind used for saving mankind in general, the second kind for saving the Hebrews. Now, a good question at this point is, what about yet another ark that is going to shortly become prominent in Exodus, the Ark of the Covenant? Shouldn't that be connected to the Ark of Moses and to the Ark of Noah? No, it shouldn't. Indeed, that would be allegory and a nice little story. First of all, the Hebrew word used for ark in the Ark of the Covenant is aron. It means a chest in the sense of a place where you store something, like a chest of drawers, okay, that kind of a chest. Interestingly, the word aron is used in only one other way and only one other time in the Bible. You know what it's used to mean? A coffin. And it refers only to when Joseph died, was embalmed, and put into a aron, a coffin. Now, somehow I think we're supposed to see something symbolic here. That the same term, aron, is used to describe both the container into which Joseph was laid to rest, as well as the container built specially to hold the original stone tablets. written on by the finger of God of the Ten Commandments. Now, frankly, I'm not really sure if the symbolism has something to do with perhaps the immense value of Joseph to God being equated with the immense value of God's laws, the Ten Commandments, or if it symbolizes something of a prophetic nature, something that is going to become apparent as time goes on. Now, it's interesting to note that in Revelation, that about the same time the Ark of the Covenant is found, it hadn't been found yet, and placed into this new temple, the tribe of Joseph also suddenly reappears. Coincidence? I don't think so. Could it be these two future events are connected? And we're being given a hint of it by the use of the word Aaron in both contexts. Well, I guess we're going to have to wait to find out. Now, no doubt the location where the little teva, the ark, which held the infant Moses, was deposited amongst the tall reeds all along the bank of the Nile was carefully chosen so that the Egyptian princess who bathed regularly at the same spot would likely discover it. But upon finding and inspecting the vessel and discovering this crying infant within it, the princess's womanly instincts took over. And she determined she was going to save this baby from his otherwise certain fate. She instantly knew this was a Hebrew child, but apparently it made no difference to her. Now we have quite an irony building here, I think. The daughter of the very man who ordered these Hebrew male babies to be destroyed is the one to save this Hebrew who had already been selected by God to liberate Israel. Even more, Israel's Savior would be raised in Pharaoh's own household. Miriam, Moses' older sister, who had watched this scene unfold, she rushed to the Pharaoh's daughter to offer her a Hebrew woman to be a wet nurse for this baby. The princess did the only practical thing she could have done. She accepted. In an irony that only God could have worked out, the infant Moses is now returned to his own mother, carried in the arms of his own sister, and now his mom is being paid by the princess to do nothing more than suckle and raise this child who was her own child in the first place. I like that. The money to pay this Hebrew mother is coming from the treasury of the Pharaoh, who has ordered the death of this selfsame infant and thousands more like him. I just love the way the Lord works. Anyway, verse 10. Verse 10 explains that the child grew. Then he was returned to the princess as her child. Now, that had to be a bittersweet moment for Jochebed as she was giving up her child. But with her, Moses' life would have been slavery. With the princess, he would have a life of royalty. Now, the Bible doesn't give us an age at which he was returned. But in general, it is thought that in those days, an infant was nursed until at least 3 years of age, though probably 5 years is more realistic, and there is ample proof it was significantly more. In fact, in tribal societies today, the average age of weaning is closer to 6 or 7. So Moses was in the childhood development stage of a kindergartner, probably, when he went to the royal palace to live. This means he knew his family well, and undoubtedly he had a fair grasp of his native Hebrew language by the time he was returned to the princess. Now, you know, being taken from his family, given to the princess, that must have been a traumatic event for little Moses. He would have become bonded not only with his own mother, but also to the Hebrew way of life. One can only imagine the psychological trauma that was caused to this young child who was torn from a life now fully imprinted on his soul and taken into a new one that was altogether different. really in direct opposition to what he came from. It would eventually overflow into frustration and rage. Well, as it turns out, Moses received his name after his return to the princess. And that name was not at first a Hebrew name. It was an Egyptian name. But as this happens in mixed populations, the Egyptian named Mose was eventually co-opted by the Hebrews and made a part of their own Hebrew vocabulary. In Hebrew, when it's used in the Hebrew sense, it means to draw out. However, in Egyptian, it is a common word with a much different meaning. Mose means child or son. So while in English we say Moses, in Hebrew we say Moshe, in Egyptian it's Mose. So we're going to see the name of many pharaohs incorporating the word Mose, along with the long-held ancient world tradition of incorporating and adding a god's name to the name of a son as a form of gratitude to some god or another. When we look at the reigns of pharaohs, we're going to see ones like Ramose, or more typically written out, Ramesses, meaning son of the god Ra, or Thotmose, meaning son of the god Thot, which we'll often see written as Thutmose, or we better know him, King Tut, or Ta-Mose, meaning son of the god Ta, so on and so forth. You get the idea. Well, between verses 10 and 11, as happens a lot in Scripture, we take a sudden leap forward in time, in this case about 35 years. Nothing is said about Moses' upbringing, but it's fairly easy to extrapolate from the vast amount of Egyptian records that have been discovered concerning royal life. He would have been given all the finest in education, in military training, the best food, the best drink, made familiar with royal court protocol. It would have been given to him, though, grudgingly. Because unlike for Charlton Heston, there would be no way whatsoever for Moses to have his Hebrew beginnings kept secret. The Egyptians knew he was a lowly Hebrew just by looking at him. And more importantly, he knew he was a Hebrew. Just as critical, the general Israelite population knew who Moses was. And to them, regardless of his Hebrew blood, he was now an Egyptian, a hated Egyptian. Moses would not have been fully welcomed in either camp. Rejected by Israelite, Egyptian alike, trapped, frustrated, Moses finally strikes out in violence. One day he sees what must have been an all too familiar sight. An Egyptian strikes a Hebrew slave. This is an event that Moses must have witnessed hundreds of times by now. This time, though, he erupts. He takes matters into his own hand. He kills that Egyptian. He buries him in the sand. A little time later, he spots two Hebrews quarreling. And he again takes matters into his own hands. He tries to separate them. He tries to play referee. But the aggressor turns to Moses and says, "What business is it of yours to interfere with this? And oh, by the way, you going to kill me like you did that Egyptian?" Oh, man. Moses blanched. His murderous act had witnesses. It was only a matter of time before the Egyptian authorities found out about this. Now, murder of an Egyptian by anyone, Egyptian or foreigner, carried the death sentence. Moses knew he had no choice but to run. And run he did, across the Egyptian border frontier of Goshen, into and across the Sinai, then across the Gulf of Aqaba, and into the land of Midian. Why Midian? Probably because they had no political ties to Egypt at this time. The Sinai was primarily Egyptian-controlled territory. They had built military outposts all along the normal trade routes that crisscrossed that vast desert peninsula. And they had also established treaties with several nations that bordered the Sinai. Moses' choice of refuge, his choices of refuge, were actually quite limited. Now, what a seemingly lonely, dreadful place Moses' life had come to. He's pursued by the Pharaoh. He's rejected by his own people, the Hebrews. His royal palace life's now exchanged for the life of a desert dweller, a fugitive desert dweller. Moses would have had his first wilderness experience long before the one that he was going to lead Israel to have. And like his forefathers, Moses, divided away and separated from his own people, Moses would now be molded. He'd be prepared by the divine, unseen hand of God in a foreign land on God's timetable. The inhabitants of his new homeland, Midian, they were the descendants of Abraham's concubine, Keturah. So Moses and the Midianites were distant relatives. As we're going to run into the Midianites at several points in the Bible, let me briefly explain. The Midianites were not actually a nation of people. They were a confederation, it seems, of five tribes. They lived not in a sovereign state called Midian, but rather it was just a region that identified the general whereabouts of these five tribes. Therefore, all of the five tribes were on the one hand called Midianites, meaning they were from the region of Midian. But on the other hand, each would have had their own tribal name, some of which we'll eventually stumble across in the Bible. Others that appear to have been lost to antiquity. Well, like so many places and people in God's Word, we get different names for the same place or same person, which makes following it all just a little bit confusing. Well, upon arrival in the region of Midian, Moses immediately has an encounter at a water well with these Midianites. Now, if we watch closely in the Bible, many meetings of importance, particularly between men and women, happen at water wells. The number of places it was considered proper and acceptable for a woman to be seen apart from her husband or father, alone or with other women, were very few. A well was one place where it was okay. And here at this well in Midian, some women shepherds show up. They begin to draw water for their sheep, only to have some local bullies show up and drive the women's sheep away, presumably wanting to water their own flocks. Well, Moses witnesses this altercation, and he's driven by his underlying anger and kind of a crusader mentality that we've been seeing develop. And he utilizes these fighting skills that he would have learned as a standard part of his royal training, and he drives these men away. And they were impressed by the skill and courage of this Egyptian, as they call Moses. So Moses suddenly finds himself with seven girlfriends who promptly takes him home to daddy. Now, why would they think that this Semite man, Moses, was an Egyptian? It would have been his lack of a beard, which characterized Egyptians, and then he would have had distinct clothing as well. Well, daddy is introduced as a fellow named Reuel. He'll also later be called Jethro. Now, Reuel, this priest of Midian, as the Bible calls him, has spawned a lot of discussion among Bible scholarship as to just who he was, what role he might have played in Moses' life. Now, first understand that the land of Midian held a lot of Midianites. Reuel is called the priest of Midian. And we're going to see this same kind of designation, the priest, in the Bible when it means to indicate the high priest of Israel. So Reuel was almost certainly the chief priest or the high priest of the Midianites. Now, the name Reuel is thought to mean friend of El. El being the name that God has called before he announced his actual name. So in one form or another, Reuel knew the true God, the one generally known at this point in history as El. Now, remembering that it was Moses himself that created the words of Exodus and most of the words from other books of the Torah, but not all, it must have seemed unimportant to him to give us much in the way of detail about Reuel or his own life in Midian, because all we know for sure is that Reuel invited Moses to live with his family. He gave Moses his daughter Zipporah as a wife, and then Zipporah gave Moses two children, the first one named Gershom. Now, Zipporah is a traditional Bedouin name to this day. It means bird, bird. Bedouins tend to give their children animal names. Now, as we're soon going to discover, though, bird hardly fits Zipporah's demeanor. Tiger, Tasmanian devil, that's a little more like it. But we'll save that for another lesson. And interestingly, take note of the name of Moses' first child, Gershom. Back when we first studied what the Hebrews meant by the term stranger or foreigner, we learned that the Hebrew word for that is Ger. So this child of Moses named Gershom means a stranger or a foreigner there. Well, in verse 23, we're informed that during Moses' long stay in Midian, the Pharaoh that was in power at the time Moses fled died. But back in Egypt, if the Israelites who had lived for so many years under the thumb of that Pharaoh that hated them so had any thoughts of the new Pharaoh maybe being a little more favorable towards them, it was wiped out immediately. But now, as the time was ripe, that cake that was Israel was ready to be pulled from the oven because the groan of the oppressed Israelites had finally reached the ear of God. It says God remembered Israel. Now, the Hebrew word for remember is zakar, zakar. Now, zakar doesn't mean remember like we think of it today. In our era, the term remember is an act of our minds calling up something from our memories. It's no more than a passive thought process. But the Hebrew zakar is an active term. It adds the element of involvement. So while we think of remember as kind of an intellectual exercise that may or may not lead to some kind of action on our part, in Hebrew, it is an action word. And that means paying very close attention to someone or something and being involved with whatever the outcome is going to be. So there's a lot of meaning in that word zakar. Now, what is key to notice is just what it was that God's action and reaction would revolve around. It was the covenant that he had made to Abraham that was then transferred to Isaac, then transferred again to Jacob, called Israel. And that covenant was that Abraham's descendants, in time refined to mean Jacob and his sons and all their descendants, they would be given a land of their own, and that El Shaddai would be their God, and that God would protect them. He would consider them his very own set-apart people, and that through this, eventually the entire world would be blessed. The process that had begun more than half a millennia earlier, that seemed dormant for nearly 400 years, as Israel languished away in Egypt, is about to burst into visible action. Let's move on to Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3. If you have a complete Jewish Bible, it's page 61. Exodus chapter 3. Now Moshe was tending the sheep of Yitro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. Leading the flock to the far side of the desert, he came to the mountain of God, to Horeb. The angel of Adonai appeared to him in a fire blazing from the middle of a bush. And he looked and saw that although the bush was flaming with fire, yet the bush was not being burned up. And Moshe said, I'm going to go over and see this amazing sight and find out why the bush isn't being burned up. And when Adonai saw that he had gone over to see, God called to him from the middle of the bush. Moshe, Moshe, and he answered, here I am. And he said, don't come any closer. Take your sandals off your feet because the place where you are standing is holy ground. I am the God of your father, he continued, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Yaakov. Moshe covered his face because he was afraid to look at God. And Adonai said, I've seen how my people are being oppressed in Egypt, heard their cry for release from their slave masters, because I know their plan, their pain rather. Because I know their pain. I have come down to rescue them from the Egyptians, to bring them up out of that country to a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the place of the Canaanite, the Hittite, the Amori, the Perizzi, the Hivi, and the Yebusi. Yes, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have seen how terribly the Egyptians oppressed them. Therefore, now come, I will send you to Pharaoh, so that you can lead my people, the descendants of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moshe said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and lead the people of Israel out of Egypt? He replied, I will surely be with you. Your sign that I have sent you will be that when you have led the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. And Moshe said to God, look, when I appear before the people of Israel and say to them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, what's his name? What am I to tell them? God said to Moses, Eye Asher Eye, and added, here's what you're to say to the people of Israel. Eye has sent me to you. And God said further to Moshe, say this to the people of Israel, Yud He Vav He, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Yaakov has sent me to you. This is my name forever. This is how I am to be remembered generation after generation. Go, gather the leaders of Israel together and say to them, Adonai, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov has appeared to me and said, I have been paying close attention to you and have seen what's being done to you in Egypt. And I have said that I will lead you up out of the misery of Egypt to the land of the Canaanite, Hittite, Amori, Perizzi, Hivi, and Yebusi, to a land flowing with milk and honey. They will heed what you say. Then you will come, you and the leaders of Israel, before the king of Egypt, and you will tell him, Adonai, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. Now please, let us go 3 days' journey into the desert so that we can sacrifice to Adonai our God. I know that the king of Egypt will not let you leave unless he's forced to do so, but I will reach out my hand and strike Egypt with all my wonders that I will do there. After that, he will let you go. Moreover, I will make the Egyptians so well disposed towards this people that when you go, you won't go empty-handed. Rather, all the women will ask their neighbors and house guests for silver and gold jewelry and clothing with which you will dress your own sons and daughters, and in this way you will plunder the Egyptians. I want to warn you, we're going to be in Exodus chapter 3 for a while. This chapter is just brimming with things that we need to know, we need to understand as a preparation for what's going to come later. Verse 1 tells us that Moses had settled into the life of a shepherd. Now, since there is no indication that Moses ever had any training in being a shepherd before he fled to Midian, one has to assume that he received on-the-job training from his wife and her sisters over a substantial period of time after he arrived in Midian. Now, interestingly, Moses apparently did not own animals of his own. These were his father-in-law's sheep that he was tending. So unlike the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, it does not appear that Moses became prosperous in Midian. Well, he moved the flock to another pasture at a place identified as Mount Horeb. Now, it's kind of important to ascertain the best we can just where this flock was moved to, because it was this location where Moses had the burning bush experience that later he would receive the Torah. Same place. In other words, wherever it was that he moved those sheep to was where the mountain of God was located. But it's also important to understand why he moved the flocks. It was to find fresh pasture land. Flocks weren't moved because a shepherd got itchy feet. Nor were they moved any further than absolutely necessary. They were moved as short a distance as possible to known and established places. I want to explain once again where Midian is. It is on the Arabian Peninsula, with its western border being the Gulf of Aqaba. Now, I did some research on the location of ancient Midian, and nowhere, not a textbook, not a map, not a reference book from any source could I find anything that put the region of Midian anywhere except on the Arabian Peninsula. Some have tried to locate a mythical part of western Midian, there is no such place, in the eastern part of the Sinai Peninsula. But there is absolutely nothing to indicate that in history. And it flies in the face of logic and simple geography. In fact, Sinai at almost all times was Egyptian territory, which is why Moses fled through the Sinai, across the Gulf of Aqaba, into Midian. He wasn't about to flee the Pharaoh and then remain in Egyptian territory. Near Egyptian military outposts, he could have been easily apprehended. Now, many archaeological finds have confirmed the unique Midianite culture. And everything of Midianite origin ever found was found only on the Arabian Peninsula. There is not one shred of evidence that the Midianites ever inhabited the Sinai. Well, without the intent of trashing anybody, it's pretty obvious from my study that the people who argue that Midian spilled over onto the Sinai Peninsula have an agenda. They have an agenda to prove that it was in Sinai where Moses drove his sheep. And this is for no other reason than for trying to defend the Christian Mount Sinai tradition as factually correct. Now, as we're soon going to see, the Bible itself doesn't confirm the standard Christian tradition site of Mount Sinai either. But it gets all the more unlikely that Moses drove his sheep to a mountain on the tip of the Sinai Peninsula because it would have required him to drive his sheep at least 50 or more miles northward along the eastern shore of the Gulf of Arabia, then do a U-turn and drive those same sheep another 75 or more miles down the other side of the Gulf of Aqaba to the site that has been designated as the place of the receiving of the law, Mount Sinai. Not only that, this route would have taken Moses and his flocks through barren desert with little to no pasture and even fewer watering holes. No shepherd in his right mind would drive sheep, which are very delicate creatures, through 125 miles of parched land just to move them to a new pasture. Rather, Moses remained on the Arabian Peninsula. He drove them, it says, to the far side or behind the desert wilderness of Midian, just like the Bible says he did. You see, verse 1 has some translators saying, Moses drove the sheep west. Others say behind or far side, some other kind of undefined general direction. Well, The only way to come up with the word west is if you work backwards from it. That is, you begin with the idea that Mount Horeb is on the Sinai Peninsula, then from where Moses actually started out in Midian, he would have to go west to get there. The problem is, of the 69 times that the word west is translated in the Old Testament, 68 of those times, the original Hebrew word is yom. Yom is the traditional Hebrew word to indicate west. The 69th time the word west is translated, it's here in Leviticus, or rather in Exodus. And guess what? The word yom is not used. Instead, we find the word achar. And of the 74 times that achar is used in the Old Testament, 73 times it's translated as behind or at the rear. Only here in Exodus have some translators chosen to make achar west. You kind of get in the picture? It's a gross mistranslation. All we know about the direction that Moses took the flocks is it was somewhere behind the wilderness, behind the desert. It could have been just about any direction. But in verse 2, we do see that wherever it was they went to where there were mountains that rimmed a desert wilderness. And it would not have been very far, 10, 20 miles probably at the most. We're going to get back into this because it's really interesting at a later date after the Israelites are released from Egypt. But for now, just know for our purposes that where Moses had his burning bush experience, it was in Midian. It was on the east side of the Gulf of Aqaba. It was on the Arabian Peninsula. It wasn't out in the Sinai Desert. And we'll continue with our study of Exodus next week.
Yeshua.